What is going on, Angels? The Champ Strider here, and today we're going to talk a bit about not just chivalry, but competitive chivalry. Now, I've been playing since the game released, but I've never played in a clan battle. The only real competitive chivalry environment I'd been in was Twitch Rivals, but now with the war against curved bubbles and playing in one of the last King's 30 vs 30 battles, I definitely see some things differently about the game. It's a completely different experience when all 60 players in the lobby are just total savages, and I was actually able to apply a lot of what I learned in my first competitive game into my second clan battle, and I was able to stay consistently at the top of the kill feeds. Now, if this video helps improve your thought process and approach to the game, be sure to subscribe for more Chivalry 2 content. Always pick the low-hanging fruit. It's something I've been very vocal about in this game. Chivalry 2 is a game of numbers. You want to eliminate as many players as quickly as you can so your team can overwhelm the remaining enemies and then complete the objectives. And this is even more important in competitive chivalry where everyone is strong mechanically. Fair fights, they'll take time. The longer a fight takes, the higher the chance you become third-partied. I'll occasionally have people in my pub stomp comments say things like, I'm only backstabbing people, and this is just such a trash mindset because as gamers, awareness and target selection are extremely important skills, and honestly, mixed with movement, it's what I think I do best as a player. And secondly, positioning and decision making are also huge, and when someone is ganked, it's actually their fault. They position badly or overextended. If someone offers you a gift, it would be rude not to accept it, and overextended players are just handing you free kills. Take them. Now, we know I tend to play very aggressively. In the competitive games, especially in my first one, you could track almost every one of my deaths down to me being impatient and overextending into 1v1 fights. In my LK match, I made much more conscious of an effort to improve this, and it showed. Again, taking ownership of the mistakes I made on decision making and positioning, I was able to greatly reduce the amounts of times I was ganked, even while defending Dark Forest, which is just generally a terrible experience. It was actually really interesting to me listening back to Ziggy Latta's pre-match interview from my event against Curved Bubbles. He spoke about how he didn't want to 1v1 anyone for the entire 2-hour event, and it was really cool to see him commit to a support role with the halberd and just chop away at people from range, but it seems we had a very similar mindset of grabbing that low-hanging fruit and picking it. On the topic of support roles, weapon reach is absolutely huge in competitive play. There's a reason spears seem to be limited for comp events, and seeing some of the spear and halberd plays, it was pretty epic. Pushing deep into fights, it's a huge risk in comp play because, well, it's way more difficult to win 1v1s, and it's also very difficult to back out of a fight against a group of high tier players. Using longer weapons like the pole arms or even the greatsword, it just provides some safety of being able to stick to your barricades or stay shoulder to shoulder with teammates and not get surrounded and mobbed on by the enemies. On defense, I actually preferred to use the greatsword for the damage and range on those overheads just to hold off being mobbed for a little bit longer. I definitely still took out my longsword for offense, however. Now, on the topic of archers or archery, they are who we thought they were. Now, I'm not going to say they're useless, and I'm not going to say there aren't a handful of players who can influence a game on Archer, but I did notice in the Curve Bubbles match, my team ran with 0 archers. His team ran with at least 4, and I think this was a huge tactical error. I'll tell you why. That means in the big melee group fights, you're letting players like myself, Randy, Ziggy, Scotty, and of course others start a melee with a 4-player advantage. I'm not sure if I've seen an archer who can keep up with the kill count we can deliver in the melee, so what happens is we're able to overwhelm many of the melee fights and then just finish off the ranged fighters directly after. I'm confident in saying I don't think a ranged player broke the middle of the scoreboard in any of the games. Now, I'll say my last huge takeaway is that engineers are the true MVPs. In public lobbies, it's very rare to see engineers have any real influence on the game, but my god, in competitive play, do engineers earn their keep? Both large-scale events I've run, the MVP award was given to an engineer. The walls and defensive structures can just stall out teams for long enough that reinforcements arrive, and just give teams a safe spot to backtrack into, to heal up, to wall off the healing stations, and just reset fights. units. We held an Asking Deer Bridge, which is extremely difficult, and I think you can credit a large part of that hole to our engineers who just stopped multiple pushes in their tracks. We even saw on a Galen Corp match, Little Pony use his structures on attack to barricade himself into objectives and destroy them before enemies were able to bring down his barricades. All right, guys, that's it here for me and my thoughts on competitive play. I want to be in those environments more. I really enjoyed it. Let me know down in the comments if you yourself have learned anything about the game playing in those pure sweat lobbies. Champ out.